We're going to go to London. All right, ready to do that? Jennifer Henneman is assistant curator at the Petrie Institute of Western American Art at the Denver Art Museum. She has a PhD from University of Washington, and she's going to take us on a comparative analysis of the reception of Buffalo Bill's Wild West in the Fine Arts Gallery, the American Exhibition, 1887, with her talk, Buffalo Bill's Wild West in the Fine Art Gallery of the American Exhibition in London in 1887. Please welcome Jennifer.
I promise it'll be more interesting than that sounded. Yeah, comparative analysis, finally. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Sam. Around these parts, I am known as JR. You're welcome to call me JR if you prefer. And returning to Cody always feels a little bit like coming home. And the reason for that is absolutely the people who are here and many of you who have created and organized and supported this event. So thank you all so much. In December of 1886, London-based American artist Anna Lee Merritt was asked to contribute paintings to the American Exhibition in London, which would open May of 1887 and feature, you will all be very surprised to hear, the first international performance of Buffalo Bill's Wild West. Now, Anna Lee Merritt responded that the sort of people who go to exhibitions and spectacles such as Buffalo Bill's Wild West, quote, don't care a pin for pictures. If you succeed in attracting any attention to the exhibition of American art, it will be a triumph, unquote. However, as we all know, between May 9th and October 31st of 1887, thousands and more, often tens of thousands of people passed through the American Exhibition daily, including through the fine arts galleries, which were sometimes, quote, packed solid with visitors so that one cannot move about but with difficulty. Now, the first international exhibition to focus on a single nation, the American Exhibition was privately funded and unapologetically a commercial endeavor meant to show British attendees how investment in American products and land could mutually benefit both countries. Placed in the heart of Britain's metropole, the American Exhibition promoted links, racial, cultural, and artistic, with the mother country, Britain, while maintaining a unique Yankee flavor, and apparently the strongest Yankee flavor was to be found in the cocktails served throughout. Now, while the Wild West looked and sounded superficially American, its narratives rearticulated the uses and benefits of imperial expansion, cloaked under the guise of bringing civilization to the darker parts of the world. Viewers, and especially Anglo-Saxon British viewers, were encouraged to see the narrative of expansion into the West as an outgrowth of their own imperial model. Thus, while Buffalo Bill's Wild West played a crucial role in presenting familiar narrative of imperial conquest cloaked in the trappings of Western Americana, these tropes had already been well established abroad via decades of popular fiction, travel writing, art, and illustration. Within this context, the fine arts galleries both reaffirmed familiar tropes of America in mountainous landscapes and in Native American genre scenes, but also provided a space in which British audiences could judge for themselves the new country's state of cultural development. Indeed, what we now, in retrospect, would view as the failure of these fine arts galleries, their conservatism, and their inability to fit within the American art canon as it developed in the 20th century, is precisely what made it perfectly suited to the mission of the American Exhibition and the Yankee takeover of London during the summer of 1887. Now, the cover of the exhibition catalog presents an excellent visual distillation of the carefully constructed portrait of America on display throughout the site. You'll notice three circular vignettes, and as articulated by the catalog authors pointing directly to this cover, it represents the history of a nation which, quote, beginning with the red man in his wilds, that's the top vignette, has passed through the processes of discovery and settlement, that's the middle vignette, and finally attained the highest development of civilization, unquote. The various components of the 23 acres of exhibition grounds supported this. And this is a buffalo, or this is a bird's eye view of the American exhibition. The Wild West would have been on the your right-hand side. You'll see the large circular arena. And here was presented the story of taming savage America. It was accessible via Warwick Road, which would have been on the far right-hand side, or via Washington Bridge here, a covered bridge that went over a railroad line. The arena was built to host 25,000 people, so understandably most people did end up there, started and or ended there, but you'll see that the grounds are actually much larger than just the arena and the encampment. Railroads, a 19th century technology that had enabled the geographical union of the United States, both bifurcated and embraced the entire site. On the opposite side of the site, your left-hand side, cultivated gardens featured a variety of North American plants in a reconstituted natural America. In between the Wild West and the gardens lay the spine of the exhibition, the main building, which measured nearly 4 football fields long and housed a wide variety of American products and manufacturers, and at the far end, the north end, a variety of very large machinery that would be turned on for certain parts of the day, and that was called Machine Hall. And you'll see to the left side of the main building, there's a dining hall here, because people gotta eat, and then this is the Fine Arts Gallery's annex, right at the heart of the entire exhibition site. The primary entrance was at Lily Road, so that front facade you see, Lily Road, spilled out there. And apparently, just in case you forgot, you had arrived at the American exhibition. When you entered, you were greeted by a handsome group of bisons, apparently taxidermic, and a stall devoted to the a dentine manufacturing company. So between bison and straight teeth, I guess America was, that was stereotypically American even in 1887. Now the narrative of America presented in London was one of positive growth according to a familiar model. From the picturesque reenactments of the Wild West frontier drama, visitors moved over Washington Bridge, right, and into the main building. And here, they spilled out right next to this manufacturer of saddles and wheels, in the right facing pianos and organs, St. Jacob's oil for conquering pain. You'll see just a plethora of products here on display. And if you continued straight across from left to right, you would end up at the Fine Arts Galleries. Now these galleries presented over 1,000 works of art by around 170 American artists working in the US, Germany, Italy, France, and England. John Sartain was chosen as the chief of the art department, and he reached his 80th year during the summer of the American Exhibition. He was well respected for his long and well-established career in the arts, particularly in Philadelphia, although he had been born in Britain and emigrated to the US when he was in his 20s, I believe. Now, one British reporter wrote that thanks to his energy and expertise, the art galleries are likely to prove quite as attractive as the Wild West show. And indeed, during the summer of 1887, the Wild West became the barometer for monitoring success. And Sartain was fully aware of this, and also fully aware that Buffalo Bill was actually bringing the people, bringing the audiences to the galleries. And he wrote to Peter Rothermel, who was then a much better known artist than he is today, that while Buffalo Bill brings the people, that which gives character and respectability to the event is the art department. Now the highest profile artist in the Fine Arts Galleries was Albert Bierstadt, who already had a reputation in Britain due to significant commissions from Englishmen during the 1860s and 1870s. Storm in the Rocky Mountains, Mount Rosalie, which is currently at the Brooklyn Art Museum and measures approximately 7 feet high by 12 feet wide before you put on its massive frame. Now this painting was purchased by English businessman T.W. Kennard in 1866, and 20 years later he lent it to the Exhibition of American Art at the American Exhibition. So in 1887, the Morning Post called this painting unquestionably Mr. Bierstadt's masterpiece, and wrote further that there is no living painter who can give one who has not visited America such an excellent idea as he can of the glorious scenery of the Yosemite Valley, or here, of the heart of the Rocky Mountains. And indeed, no one had done more than Albert Bierstadt to establish the American Western scene. After going west to the Wind River Mountains in 1859, and then to Yosemite and Colorado, and then Yosemite in 1863, he had returned with hundreds of sketches. So just to give you an idea of his process, here's Storm in the Mountains, and this is an oil sketch, much, much smaller, lap-sized, right, oil sketch that he did at Chicago Lakes, which is just west of Denver, beautiful hike. He's sitting on the lower bank of Lower Chicago Lakes, and he's got his artist box open on his lap, and he's painting en plein air, in the open air. And he's really concerned with the very quickly changing effects of light and in the mountains on a day that was quite stormy. Now I hope to see very immediately the formal differences between the small sketch on the right and the much larger painting on the left, which he executed later using sketches such as this when he got back to New York in his studio there. I mean, immediately you can see the differences in the saturated color, the much more dramatic lights and darks. You'll notice the composition of the large painting is much more complex. There are multiple fore and middle and backgrounds, and the ways in which your eyes loop through that painting, the way he's articulated the clouds and the soaring peak, your eyes continually circle around, sometimes landing on that small vignette in the front where you see a variety of American Indian figures hunting and watering their horses, which help draw you in to this much larger scene, which you then must step back from to really, really understand in the full. But also notice that he's preserved the horizontal compositional axis of that lower lake as the grounding line from which everything else rises and falls. So the evidence of Western grandeur presented by Bierschaet's large painting, such as Storm in the Mountains, proved useful in context of the American exhibition. Among the 11 paintings he exhibited there, at least 5 of them were Western American subjects, and these corroborated the supposed truth of the view of the American West depicted on the backdrops of Buffalo Bill's Wild West. This is my highly scientific method of trying to re-grasp what that backdrop looked like by correlating 3 cabinet cards taken by Elliott and Fry of Cody during the 1887 exhibition. And I use this example simply to point out that by this point in time, the American West had become, to quickly identify a place as the American West, there were a series of visual tropes or iconographies. And you see a number of them here on the right-hand side, those jagged steep cliffs, reminiscent of Yosemite. You see wooded mountain hills. You see apparently some kind of a scree bank descending to a riverbed. And then although the picture is faded on the top left, there are snow-capped peaks along the entire left-hand portion. The large canvas backdrops in the arenas presented geographies deeply indebted to Bierschaet and others who had gone west, including the photographer William Henry Jackson, whose photographs were also on display in the fine arts galleries. Now this is a photograph of the Grand Canyon, possibly on display in London that summer. And here I present a comparison. The lower right-hand side is a Jackson photograph that has been scanned in black and white. It's of Garden of the Gods in Colorado. And on the left-hand side is one of my favorite photographs from this summer because those elk look so startled to be in London after having been shipped over for the entire summer. But notice the backdrop behind them, these very large rounded rock forms, which are reminiscent of the kinds of monumental geographies that artists and photographers had already well established as the American West. They became shorthand for signaling a specific place, which, as we know, is much larger than a specific place, but in the popular imagination, the American West. Now, while Bierschaet had been lauded in the 1860s for revealing the truth of the American West's geological and natural wonders, his critical reputation faltered in the 1870s, when his paintings were more often criticized as cold, hard-edged, and unfeeling. Art critics increasingly privileged the sensual expression of oil paint and the subjective interpretation of the artist's personal vision. In contrast, Bierschaet's meticulous works appeared overdone and forcibly dramatic. Thus, at the American Exhibition, one reviewer remarked that his paintings were grandiose but scarcely sensitive. Now, another was actually surprised by the fine quality of Bierschaet's works, given his faltering reputation, but nonetheless confessed that Mr. Bierschaet's pictures always looked to me tricky and rather more like scene paintings than genuine artistic works. Identifying Bierschaet as a very good scene painter and not simply a good painter, pointed to his outdated artistic style, one that attempted to delineate the natural facts of a location in a manner found increasingly to be too photographic. But scene painter also referenced an outdated form of spectacle. Scene painting hearkened to the panorama, a widely popular 19th century entertainment, by the 1880s on the wane, even though you could still find them in a few spots. Now, in a panorama, as you might know, they're composed of massive, massive painted canvases that are mounted fully in the round, and you actually go underground and come up right in the middle of the panorama, which is in a round building, purpose-built for the panorama, and you feel, therefore, immersed in a specific location or a specific scene, such as the Civil War. Civil War scenes were very popular in the 1870s as panoramic subjects. Then the circular structure of the Wild West Arena was also in part indebted to its panoramic precedent. Thus, scene painting, like panoramas, and like the Wild West, and apparently like Bierstadt's paintings, these were meant for the masses. For this reason, some critics lamented the lack of serious or advanced art in the fine art galleries, pointing specifically to the absence of very well-known American artist John Singer Sargent, who that same summer exhibited this painting, Carnation Lily, Lily Rose, at London's Royal Academy. There, at this most prestigious of British art institutions, it was the most talked about painting of the summer and was ultimately purchased by the British government. Now, generally, the fine arts galleries of the American exhibition received positive reviews, though always with the caveat that America was still maturing in its cultural refinement. One commentator remarked that the galleries had indeed taken the world here by storm because of the number of first-class artists which it possesses. But others pointed out that, in fact, there is no American school. In America, artists have not yet advanced beyond the imitative stage. You see and recognize this or that style, but all of the styles, they're familiar to you. Now, in some cases, the styles appeared to be taken right out of the British playbook. Consider, for example, when the Morning Post wrote that William Lamb Picknell's magnificent picture, A Wintry March, which you see here, was so powerfully painted, the management of light and shade so admirable, that it might, but for a certain finesse, be taken for a constable. Now, Constable was one of the preeminent landscape painters of England in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. That was a little bit of a backhanded stab. Now, the same reviewer who found the galleries lacking in serious and advanced art nonetheless recommended visiting them simply to see essentially how their influence had impacted American art. For example, in particular, the influence of our own great school of portraiture of 100 years ago. This reviewer is referring to the Grand Manner tradition of the 18th century, the echoes of which you see in this full-sized, full-length portrait of Queen Victoria, painted by the American artist Thomas Sully in 1838, the year after she had become queen at the tender age of 18. Now, one gets the sense that the British really relished patting themselves on the back for all that they had taught these growing, learning American artists. This portrait of the queen confronted viewers immediately upon their entry to the fine arts galleries. And here is a photograph from the souvenir album of 1887. It's the only photograph that exists, that I know of the fine arts galleries themselves. And I just want to take a quick tangent and point out, Louis, I know how much the centaur means to you, and there's a bronze relief called Centaurs at Play right there, behind the model of Philadelphia City Hall. They're everywhere. So you see that once you had crossed that main building from Washington Bridge, this is where you end up. This is called the Queen's Gallery, or Gallery C. Here, Victoria presides not only over American paintings and sculpture, but also, as you can see through the door on the left, over the molded bodies of American wildlife. Within the fine arts galleries, two rooms were devoted to a most curious and interesting collection of hunting trophies. Now, do you see the same full body mount of this mountain sheep here, right, that we saw through the door here? This is looking to the right towards Gallery A, and this view is looking the other direction towards Galleries E and F. Crucially, these specimens had been hunted by Englishmen in North America. They therefore underscored British engagement in the taming and mapping of the American West, a process on display in Buffalo Bill's Wild West in the buffalo hunt portion of the performance, which I give you just the actual North American wildlife shipped over again for the event. Now, tellingly, I'll just get back to this picture since it's so great. The Hall of American Trophies was utilized as the site of British-US diplomacy during the last week of the American exhibition. According to the Morning Post, a large number of representatives from each of the two great English-speaking nations met here in these walls to discuss the subject of international arbitration as the most natural tribunal for the settlement of disputes, rather than going straight to war. The ensuing evocations of friendship and brotherhood reinforced the messaging of the American exhibition from the beginning that the US and Britain were linked by Anglo-Saxon blood, by shared economic interests, and by high-end hobbies, the evidence of which stared unblinkingly down upon them from the walls of this hall. A strange amalgam of artworks and animal bodies, the fine arts galleries present a productive space for thinking through the reception of American art and culture in London, with a special relevance for better understanding how the British positioned themselves and their own culture and achievements in relationship to this growing nation. The fine arts galleries were admittedly and non-threateningly conservative. A firm traditionalist, John Sartain, who was the chief of the art department, disliked what he called the faddish work of the day, in particular pointing to Impressionism, which he criticized as blotchy, sloppy, and without respect for principles, reason, and technical skill. Not only would the forms of Impressionism and Post-Impressionism have been denied entry by Sartain, such avant-garde styles would not have supported the very clear links made throughout the exhibition of America's indebtedness to Britain's example. A study of the fine arts galleries also demonstrates their inextricable connection to Buffalo Bill's Wild West. First, because everything that summer was judged in relationship to the Wild West and its popularity. But secondly, because of the resonance between the visual tropes of the American West on display in the galleries and the arena. Unlike the galleries, however, the Wild West was a truly modern spectacle, a combination of theater, panorama, and authentic Western athleticism perfectly suited to its time. During the second half of the 19th century, such urban spectacles became curious fodder for artists, and you can think of any number of paintings in Paris, for example, by Degas or Manet or Lautrec, or in England, of the American rebel artist, James Abbott McNeill Whistler. Now, Whistler was certainly not present in the fine arts galleries of the American exhibition, but he did attend the exhibition in 1887. And there he made sketches of Buffalo Bill's Wild West, which he later turned into three etchings, one of which you see here. Now, these images are incredibly austere. They're composed of very simple lines delineating the arms of the arena and the backdrop, the orator Frank Richmond on his podium there in the arena, the clouds above, the London chimney tops, and then in the front left foreground, the frivolous hats of Victorian women. Here, the entertainment of the masses has become fine art worthy. And apparently it was indeed possible to attend the American exhibition and still give a pin for pictures. Thank you very much.